Seneca Sodi Journey to the Throne. A visit to Jonah Palace and the neighborhood of the prophets. We were still visiting this park at the summit of this heavenly mountain. We finally reached the limits of the park to realize that we were at the highest point of an immense chain of mountains of paradise. Looking at the horizon beyond the immense valleys and vast plains, we were truly delighted with wonder. In the beautiful and limpid atmosphere of the heaven, one could see a considerable distance, and we could also distinguish to the bottom of the valleys which plunged several leagues above us. The roads which descended by winding along the flanks of these mountains, with such a variety of trees on the sides, rendered the landscape which stretched before us without any comparison with anything in the whole creation. In admiring these marvels, I addressed David with the words of the Queen of Sheba. I said I was told half of it, 1 Kings 10 verse 7, and also these are things which the eye has not seen, which the ear has not heard, and which are not assembled in the heart of man, of the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. 1 Corinthians 2 verse 9. When one looked through the depths of the valley, as along the slopes of the mountains, we could see an innumerable number of mansions and temporary residences of those who preferred to spend much of their time in these regions. I thought again of our Lord's words, "I go to prepare a place for you, that where I am, there ye may be also." How much he has provided in abundance. My wife Genevieve came near me and asked, "Mr. Sodi, is your curiosity satisfied?" I replied, "Satisfied. Is there a single soul here that is not satisfied? I have climbed to the top of many of the highest mountains of the earth, but they are only molehills compared to those wonders of paradise. On the other hand, just think of the fact that they are here for eternity. We will be able to enjoy it forever. No illness, no old age, no death, no sadness, no tears. Redeemed and saved forever." I said, "Genevieve, how happy I am that we are here. What glorious heights are those to which we have been raised. And considering that not long ago we were in the world subjected to sickness, sorrow and death, now all this is past, no more death. But in heaven we are equal to the angels, and with the redeemed of all ages. Such a blessing will be among the elect for eternity." David now came and said, "We must continue our journey," and so, bidding our holy brethren goodbye, we returned to the chariot, after gathering our supply of fruit, as well as drink from the boiling waters of gushing fountains of paradise. We resumed our place in David's celestial vehicle, ready to continue our journey to the city of the great king. We sung a hymn of praise for these great wonders. As soon as we had begun to sing to the Lord, many hundreds of saints gathered quickly. When they saw David standing in the chariot with his harp, they joined with us in loud hallelujahs to God. So the chariot moved on, leaving the mountain scenery behind us. Our route was through a broad but beautiful valley. We could see such great distances before us thanks to the perfectly clear light of paradise. The great terrestrial orchards, and all the plantations of orange and lemon trees, are but tiny gardens compared to what lay now before us. We were leaving the high altitudes and we were coming down. On each side of us, as far as the eye could see, stretched immense orchards of trees of all kinds and shapes. They were loaded with fruit and decorated with flowers among the most beautiful, as I had never seen before. I was bewildered with this magnificent glory and wonderful provision of our God. I fell on my face. Genevieve and Mary both joined me and blessed aloud, "The God who had given us life, O God, Thou Maker of all. O Lord Jesus, Thou Redeemer and Saviour, with high thanksgiving we pour out our souls to Thee." When we got up, my mother said to me that from this region here very large quantities of provisions are transported to the city, vast supplies of fruit are taken into the city. My mother said, "Look at those convoys and trainloads over there. Wonderful!" I exclaimed. In fact, I saw hundreds of people loading prime fruits and heavenly vegetables of all kinds. We crossed these orchards for 100 leagues. I saw several thousand fully happy beings reaping the fruits of these beautiful orchards, and loading convoys that was heading to the celestial city. Then my wife Genevieve asked me, "Do you see the light of the city over there?" "Yes, absolutely. My joy is extreme. I have the impression that heaven is a perpetual morning of June." "How well you have judged," said David. "The Son of God, the Lamb himself, is the light of heaven. Yes, this eternal kingdom is like in a perpetual morning of June. In fact, there's no winter here. We began to see the wall of the city and the gate of Simeon which stood before us. I said, please David, would you slacken the speed the chariot before passing the gate of Simeon? Please give us more time to admire the majesty of this mighty wall, and to read again the names of the foundations upon which it is erected. The angel standing at this gate of Simeon greeted us gracefully with a wave of his hand. I asked Genevieve, why do the angels guard these gates bearing the names of the 12 tribes of Israel? She said, had it not been for the 12 tribes of ancient Israel paving this way before us, and giving us the alphabet and spelling of the eternal mysteries of God, such an abundant entrance into the city would have never happened. If the 12 tribes of Israel had not opened the way before us, we could not have such access to the city, and similarly to Israel, which was advancing slowly to its ancient capital. At each annual festival, we would not have done better. Also, with the growing number of people entering and gathering at these gates, there would have been bottling and blockade for our utmost confusion. That is why the angel stands there only to guide the crowd, to keep the perfect order, and to welcome all those who are prepared to receive the blessings of the city and its dwellings. Ignorance is not an obstacle for crossing these gates. On the other hand, the non-resemblance to the blessed face of Jesus is an obstacle. It is the angels who decides about who to let in. Genevieve said that the ancient Israel opened the way. They went before all of us Gentiles. God had prepared for them a city, and they looked forward with longing eyes toward their inheritance. It is true, my dear Genevieve. I remember a precious verse from the Bible that we love very much on earth. It speaks of Abraham saying, by faith he dwelt in the promised land as a stranger in a foreign country. He lived in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise, for he was looking forward to the city with foundations, whose architect and builder is God. Hebrews 11 verse 10, so true, said Genevieve. These ancient saints died in faith, full of the promises of God, which they saw afar off, and they were persuaded of them and they embraced them. And so they confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth, desiring a better country, which was this heavenly kingdom. So God was not ashamed to be called their God, because he had built for them this eternal city. How true! I said, no one but the true and eternal God could have built a city like this for them and for us. David's chariot had been standing still for some time during our conversation, and he was quietly listening to us. He turned to us and said, I had great pleasure listening to your conversation. For hundreds of years before the Gentile period came, thousands of Jews crowded at these gates. At that time we were here mostly Jews, but now the Gentiles are far ahead of us. They are nevertheless our brothers, for after all they are the seed of Abraham and heirs of the promise. But we must now pass along. Then David's chariot moved slowly under the archway of the great golden gate of Simeon. The angel waved us goodbye as we left the wondrous gate and the majestic wall behind us. My mother said to David, can you kindly take us to the Cathedral of the Children? I asked her, are you impatient to see the little ones again? I'm always very happy to be among them, but I would like to assure you that I had a great pleasure in making this trip with you. We all agreed in the same way, but no one had enjoyed it as much as I did. Everything was so new, so wonderful and unforgettable. I said to David, who was assigned to assist us, the avenue is here is very wide, so you can go to the speed you like. Holding out his arms, he pressed the button again. It seemed like the heavenly vehicle was flying with the wings of light. Shortly afterwards, we were slowing down at the Children University gates. We all went down and thanked David for his gracious service. He said, I'm always happy to be at service to you. Then he directed his vehicle to the opposite side of the street and picked some fruit. We remained for a moment to recall that magnificent journey we had just made. Genevieve, Mother and Mary stood in front of the entrance to the Children's University. David's car was parked on the other side of the avenue, and he was gathering fruit and filling his basket. Then I saw Bohemond coming towards us, and I signaled to him to hurry. Bohemond, I have a lot to tell you. Many wonderful things have happened since we parted. I would first like to introduce you to Genevieve, who was my intimate companion, the woman of my youth. I found her a short time ago. She was very busy serving and teaching in preparatory class people arriving from Earth to the gate of this eternal kingdom. In one of the remote station of paradise, Genevieve seemed very glad to know that we were close friends. "When are you going to the throne?" Bohemond asked me. "Well, very soon, I think." Then Genevieve said, "If you like, you can go right away. Mother, Marie and myself will join you a little later at the great gathering." So we beckoned David to come to us. He quickly consented to be at our service as we decided to leave, and as we were exchanging goodbyes, Genevieve said to David, "Take the road of the mansions and palaces of the prophets, and call at Jonah House." After having kissed Genevieve's lips to say goodbye as we used to do on Earth, I found myself in David's chariot with my friend from Russia. We took the direction of the interior of the city. In fact, from the moment I set foot outside of the celestial chariot in my very first arrival in paradise, I had one objective: to reach and contemplate the throne of my Father God. I had already seen our blessed Savior Jesus and looked at his holy face, but I wanted to see the throne of the Father, and the crowds that would certainly gather there. "All your desires and much beyond," says David, "will soon be fulfilled. But you showed wisdom by not pressing yourself to the throne. For even now your preparation is not excessive for this extreme glory. Your journey to paradise will only make you better prepared for what is waiting for you. It is indeed something far beyond that." "I have been very much taken in different parts of the city," said Bohemond, "since the last time I saw you. But I sincerely thank you for the opportunity you offer me to go with you to the throne." "David, please tell us a little bit about the houses of the prophets that Genevieve has evoked." "With the greatest pleasure," he said. "A great number of prophets and men of ancient of Israel, including the patriarchs, have their houses not far from here. They regrouped in order to be able to contact each other quickly. People are free to visit their mansions and their area if they want. It is not considered to be an intrusion to come and stay there if you want. Everything in the city belongs to each of us. We are the heirs of the whole kingdom, so God has prepared all this for me." "Really?" David said. "It is as true as you are in the city." I said, "I remember the passage from the scripture where God declares, 'All is yours, and you are of Christ, and Christ is of God.'" 1 Corinthians 3:23. Then my friend from Russia said, "I'm wondering about my own house and where it might be." "Be patient, my son," said David. "God will place you in your house and your satisfaction will be total. But remember that your privileges are unlimited and unbounded in the kingdom of heaven as a whole. In the city as in paradise, so go wherever you want to go and where it pleases you. And be satisfied forever." Actually, no photographic apparatus ever recorded on Earth anything like this celestial glory. Since we left the Children's University, the heavenly car was rolling at an indescribable speed. We were traveling several kilometers and we were talking about our respective experience of heaven. I noticed among all avenues and streets of the city, this one here was most gorgeously decorated. A branch of the River of Paradise was flowing in the midst of this avenue. On either side were growing the trees of life scattered here and there, among them very beautiful groves of trees of various truth. Then said David, "We are approaching the mansions of the elders and the prophets," and after slackening his chariot speed he said, "You will undoubtedly recognize the names of the people who live here, for the many names you see there are familiar to all those who know Jewish history. Upon the gate and posts of the verandas and other places were the names of many of the ancient saints and prophets of God." David said, "They are always glad to welcome all the new arrivals, as well as their old friends." I asked David, "Are we going to Jonah House?" "Of course," he said. A few minutes later the celestial chariot stopped on the threshold of a superb and beautiful palace. "I see the name of the prophet," said Bohemond. "That's right," said David. "It is indeed the authentic Jonah of the Bible. I hope for you, dear brothers, that he is inside his palace." We jumped out of the celestial vehicle. David was leading the way. He said, "There are no doorbells to ring in heaven, for everyone is always welcome." It would be as if a bee was asking permission to enter his hive. A saint of heaven does not have to ask another to receive him in his house, for there is an eternal brotherhood here, and all things are in common. This is something that we know very little on Earth. Then David said, "I can see Jonah now through the corridor. We rejoiced exceedingly when we heard that. We entered his mansion, he came toward us and David saluted him saying, "Good morning my brother."
"Good morning to you," said Jonah. "I am always glad to have you come in. Tell me, who are these brothers with you?"
"Recent arrivals from Earth. This is Brother Sodi, a Greek of Jewish descent, but the latter is from the Scandinavian people. Brother Bohemond is from northern Russia."
"Glad to welcome you, dear brethren," he said holding out his hand. We were soon all seated in his spacious mansion, beautiful with adornments as no earthly home has ever been decorated. As I looked about I thought of our Lord's words on earth, "I go to prepare a place for you," John 14 verse 2. These many mansions prepared by the Almighty hand. Then I thought again, if he has made such an endless variety of flowers, sweet-scented and lovely shrubbery of all kinds, with so many things to please and enhance our earthly lives, what will he not provide for his saints and his bride in heaven?
"Well, Jonah," I said, "we're very happy to see you. But tell me, are you really the prophet Jonah who was so remarkable in biblical times on earth?"
"Evidently I am the prophet Jonah, the son of Amittai. I grew up in Gath Helpa, an ancient city of Lower Galilee, in the territory of Zabulon. I arrived in this heavenly kingdom more than 2,700 years ago, but if we count that the way it is done in heaven, it is only 2 days and a half.
Tell us about your experience with the whale, Jonah."
"There is a lot of skepticism about this story," he said. "Well, it is entirely true, but how I lived inside this great fish I cannot say. I only know that I spent 3 days there, but the animal was as ill as I was. I have been asked these same questions thousands of times. It is an old story to me, yet ever new and ever true, because God's hand was present both to punish and to save me. If I had persisted in my disobedience it would have meant the destruction of Nineveh, but my repentance and my fidelity have engendered his salvation. Yes, whatever the mockers say, this story is true. Obviously there was a miracle, but that was followed by the greatest awakening that no city has ever known. My punishment and repentance were a sign for the Ninevites. They repented, for God exercised his mercy while I was angry, oh the sinner that I was. But God also exercised his mercy toward me, and many Ninevites have been saved and are now in heaven."
"Jonah," I said in a loud voice, "I wish you could go back to earth to repeat your story. Many people quibble about the word of God and ridicule it from what is said about you."
"Yes," replied Jonah, "and they do it for their own destruction. Many important and strange things have happened and will happen again. Some are so strange that men will continue to doubt and quibble as they have always done. And yet these things are real. We are very glad to have met you and to have heard your story from your own lips. We had always thought that the word was true. Besides, 800 years after you lived, our Lord made reference to you, making you the sign of his own death and resurrection. Everything was absolutely true," said Jonah. "And the skeptics, who were very many when the Lord was on earth, will rise in the day of judgment at the same time as the men of Nineveh, and the Ninevites will condemn them. It will be the same with the scoffers of the last days, who will have had much more light than even the men of the time of our Lord. David spoke and said, 'In my day many great things have happened. The hand of God was on me daily. He has given me so many deliverances that one could write a whole book.'" The men who then lived on earth generally accepted these providential interventions as the active hand of God towards human affairs. "All right," said Jonah to David, "when I lived 200 years after your death, everyone seemed to talk about you as someone whom God had greatly honored. I said to Jehovah, 'We are now going to the throne. I am very anxious to behold the glory of that most wonderful place in heaven, about which we have sung and prayed throughout our earthly lives, and just to think that I am so near to it now. Glory to my God. My soul overflows with delight. I cannot contain myself longer.'"
"Tune your harps," said David. Then we sang in the highest tone of our voices, "The wonders of our God, our King."
"But realize," I exclaimed, "we are in heaven, and in the house of Jonah the prophet, near the throne of God."
Then Jonah said to us, "I was very happy to meet you, dear brothers. You lived on earth nearly 3,000 years after my time. I am glad that together we can now give thanks to God." At these words we prostrated ourselves with praises and adoration towards our God. When we stood up Jonah said,
I hope to meet you near the throne during the great gathering. Millions of saints are presently there, so I hope to meet you there." He held out his hand and we said goodbye. Then we got back into David's celestial car, and we went to the center of the heavenly kingdom. I asked David, "Are we not near the throne?" "Quite near," said David, "but we are approaching it from another quarter." At this time the light of the celestial kingdom seemed so bright yet not dazzling, for we were being prepared for that glory, and while we're riding in this region of paradise I could see millions of joyous souls passing by us. Numerous gatherings were organized in different places of paradises in preparation of the great convocation before the throne of the Father. Then David said, "We must stop, I see an angel calling me." Then he got out of the celestial car. After a few minutes of discussion with the angel he returned and told us that he was to leave us. He was asked to go to a distant place in the city. "I think I will only leave you for a short time," said David. "You can relax by strolling if you feel like it, or ask to enter any house if you desire. Feel right at home. Everything you see belongs to you." "I'll make a quick move to a remote part of the city from here. It is in connection with the organization of the great gathering around the throne of the Father. If I do not return in time for you, you can get in any of the celestial chariots, and you will be taken to the throne in due time." At these words we got out of his celestial vehicle. He said goodbye with a gracious bow and waving his hand and he went away. After we left David's chariot, Bohemond and I walked alone. We were plunged into a profound consideration of all these marvels, of the omnipotence and love of God. We then reached a very beautiful park in which we entered. We did not even walk for long when we saw a group of elders, among whom were Abraham and Moses, Joshua and Isaiah, Peter and John, Paul and Silas, and many others. They were engaged in a spiritual discussion. They beckoned to us. They said, "We are glad to see you again, for we have learned that our Lord has benevolent intentions in regard to you." "Well, dear brothers, we do not know what still awaits us, but we have seen how God is full of infinite graces, and all that we discover is of great interest to us." "We are delighted," said Abraham. "It was with wisdom that you were led to our conference, and I've seen the magnitude of everything you've visited so far." Then we began a discussion of theology as it is now taught in the terrestrial churches. "If you are interested, we invite you to stay with us for a while. Feel free to ask us any questions you may have, and you can also participate in the answers on the points we are discussing." We replied together and spontaneously, accepting their kind invitation. It must not be frequent indeed to meet so many men of such capacity. Even those who have contributed more than all the others to the faith of the Christian Church. After their conversation about theology, Abraham resumed, "We are very interested in all that concerns the church that is on earth, perhaps even more than those who still inhabit their earthly houses." He said to us, "You have recently arrived from the earth, that we are glad to see you now among us. It is really a great privilege for us," I said, "to sit down with you at this conference." Moses handed us a basket of delicious fruit they were sharing. "In the last few years," said Abraham, "theology has been very neglected. Theology deals with the existence, character and attributes of God, His laws and His government, the doctrines that men must believe, and the obligations they have to put into practice. We have been informed that serious mistakes have infiltrated many branches of the church. The true religion is the life of man who is personally in contact with God. It is the recognition of God in all our actions. It is the bond that unites man to God. This faith integrates His presence and invites Him in all the affairs of human life. It is the life of God in the soul of man, and is manifested daily in a concrete morality." "What difference between theology and religion?" I asked. "The true religion," says Abraham, "the authentic spiritual life refers to the presence of God in the heart of man, and in his life which he submits to the obedience of all divine will." "As for theology," says Moses, "it is a scientific system which deals with God and with the laws by which man is saved. But a man can be a theologian like many scribes and Pharisees, without experiencing the divine life. The source of all true theology is God Himself, in the revelations which He has bestowed on man." "Well," said Bohemond and I at the same time, "we would be much pleased to have a brief statement or summary of your teachings as you understand them now, for we would like to compare our own ideas of theology. and that which is now taught in the churches, Abraham spoke and said, "We will hand you such a statement shortly. In the meantime, if you care, you can take a flying trip in one of the passing chariots to a praise service to be held on the Broadway, or visit the park adjoining the throne." We thanked them for their friendly service, and as we stepped on board of a chariot, they said to us, "We will see you again soon," and they waved us a pleasant goodbye. Isaiah kindly offered his services to go with us. We thanked him, and the chariot soon slowed up at an entrance where thousands were gathering for praise service. The place seemed to contain a space somewhat equal to a 10- or 12-acre field of the earth. There were seats arranged circularly around an immense central space. The orchestra was on an elevated position in this central space. They were 1,000 of redeemed with their harps and their voices, to carry this vast audience with the melodies of heaven. It seemed to me that the harp and the voice of David were so melodious during this service. There were many early fathers of the church there. Many of those who had suffered persecution and the martyrdom were also there. Their faces shone with a peculiar joy as their words spread like a perfumed oil on this marvelous assembly. At the suggestion of Bartholomew, one of the 12 apostles of Jesus, we all fell on our knees and prostrated against the ground. We gave to God with one heart and one voice all the glory that came back to Him. Several brief sermons were delivered to the thousands of assembled believers. Many like us were recent arrivals in the city. This gathering resembled to a preparatory meeting for the great convocation to be held at the throne. Isaiah, with his long floating beard, spoke as if he had a silver trumpet, announcing the general course which had just been set up for this great manifestation. The face of Enoch shone like that of the angels as he proclaimed the glory of his Lord. John the Baptist too, in a piercing voice, made the congregation vibrate as if by a flame of fire. Mary, the earthly mother of Jesus, was also there. Her sweet voice was like waves of light on this crowd. We discovered that she was highly esteemed in heaven. Priscilla and Aquila both expressed words of great kindness, and many others testified of the great goodness of God. Then we all rose to sing a doxology. Then with one soul and one voice came the praises of Him who redeemed us for God by His blood.